Macmillan Audio presents Rouge, a novel of beauty and rivalry by Richard Kirshenbaum. Narrated for you by Lauren Ezzo and P.J. Ochlan. Rouge was different, an entity unto itself, a substance far more fraught than the pastes and powders and creams of the time. Rouge was imbued with a deeper meaning, a natural state of a woman inviting approach. Rouge was the color of invitation, arousal just before, during, and after sex. And for this reason, the amplification of rouge, the high-flushed pink or even red sheen of a woman's cheeks, was considered, at first, the realm of a disreputable woman.
Prologue. New York City, 1983. The morning was overcast, a dead shade of gray, and this was horribly fitting. It was as though God knew that the bright spot of my world was gone, and without her critical eye, the sky could let its guard down and bore us with its dullest shade. Madame always detested the color gray. As she often said, "It's neither here nor there, and I cannot abide indecision." She would utter the word indecision with her usual verve and a raised penciled eyebrow. She most definitely would not have approved. I assumed the weather would comport itself in time for the burial. I decided to take a Xanax with my mimosa before the funeral. Not because of an outpouring of grief, but rather due to the sheer fact that Madame had actually died. It was inconceivable that the life force had left her, or as she would exclaim, "Capote," when she read the obituary of a friend or an acquaintance in the newspaper, the sound of her large cabochon emeralds slamming into her marble-topped guéridon. From the moment I met her, a mere lad of 27, she was invincible to me. Indestructible, immortal, and outsize. She appeared as a giant in my eyes, even though she stood only 5 feet tall, her tight black chignon setting off stormy eyes and a strong aquiline nose. Her beauty was striking even when she was in her 80s. Strangely, I always see her in profile, dramatic even in silhouette. I could not picture life without her. The rants, the demands, the to-do lists, the details, large and small, and occasionally, the endearing gifts that she dispensed just when I thought I couldn't bear her another second. Her caresses were almost always gruff, yet her endearments, when offered, were surprisingly generous. They were often embarrassing. From lavish David Webb animal print enameled cufflinks to Calvin Klein briefs when she knew a new man was on the horizon. "Babisiu," she would say in her native Polish. "Baby, bring me a cup of tea, the Times and the magazines." When she was melancholy, she would stroke my face. "You remind me of my first husband," she would say. "May he roast in hell." And she would read the papers to see if she had been profiled in the party pictures and to cluck at her own glossy advertisements. My name is Bobby DeVries. It wasn't always. I was born Joe Bob Devereaux. I'm a southern boy, backwater trash from Louisiana. However, thanks to my abundant charm, boyish good looks, hidden assets, and a few, shall we say, favors along the way, I was propelled from the bayou to New York, where I answered an ad for a domestic service agency and was dispensed to Josephine's maison. I was told she hired only good-looking young people who had no family and no life. I certainly fit the bill. Once ensconced in Chez Josephine, I had the great fortune to attend the University of Madame Josephine Hertz. It was a master's degree in business and in life, and she prepared me for all of the tasks at hand. She was at once a tough general and rancorous professor, and she tore me up and made me over a million times. One night, when I was collecting her legendary Van Cleef zipper necklace and depositing it in the wall safe, she lay on the bed on her aqua satin pillows in her mamboche, her dark eyes pitched skyward, and she rechristened me Bobby DeVries. "Tell them you're from the Charleston DeVrieses," she said. "You'll get more respect." "Who are the Charleston DeVrieses?" I asked. "How the hell should I know?" she quipped. She loved saying my new name, the "duh" being the punctuation point. "Bobby DeVries, get me a glass of tea with a sugar cube." Or, "Bobby DeVries, my babisio, get me my jewel box. I want the emeralds." I was totally entranced from the moment I started as her junior butler, and finally, after many years, once I had proven my unflagging loyalty, as her personal assistant. The day before, I had provided the funeral home with her black Chanel boucle suit and her favorite diamond star pin. I sat with the family in the drawing room. Johnny Blake Hertz, her grandson, always seemed to detest me. But his newest wife, Charlene, was smart enough to know I held many of Josephine's deepest secrets, the most valuable possessions in the vault. Charlene made sure I had proper seating in the limousines and a front row seat at Temple Emmanuel. There was the will to consider, of course, and my 20 years of servitude had accrued to my being named as a trustee. Many of Madame's orders and wishes were already known to me, and I had made these my own. As Madame used to say somewhat sardonically, "Where there's a will, there is a relative." The long black limousine pulled up to the temple's imposing carved limestone facade, revealing a ring of omnipresent photographers, all there to record the comings and goings of the rich and famous. After all, Madame Josephine Hertz, née Josiah Herzenstein, and much later, Princess Orloff, when she remarried in her 40s, had cut a wide swath through international society. At 83, she was more powerful than ever. Her death sent shockwaves through the business and social press. "The death of beauty," they wrote. "An icon joins the firmament." Josephine was credited with inventing the beauty business, and in turn becoming the wealthiest self-made woman in the known world. This, Josephine would not hesitate to remind me, was back when women could not get a loan. When she was animated or angry, her true accent emerged, and the W's always became V's. She would, of course, bang the table with her emerald cabochon or Burmese ruby when retelling this story. Chanel sunglasses and flowers were in abundance in the soaring synagogue, as were furs of every species, chinchilla, mink, sable. A throng gathered for the first wave of important guests: Barbara, Frank, Lauren, and Pamela. These people needed no introduction to the press or to one another. The vast ceiling height was perhaps the one thing that could overpower all of these egos. The rest of the synagogue was filled with what I call the professional mourners, the climbers who wanted to be seen at her funeral. It was arguably the most important event on the New York social calendar for the season, and of course, a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity for networking. "There's nothing like a good funeral," the great comedian Alice Stark had often said. She often relayed to her good friend Josephine the business connections she had made when someone famous passed away. Today would be no different. They would all come. Friends, colleagues, relatives distant and near, and of course, rivals and enemies. Many of these people had had a front row seat to Madame's century. Madame's close-knit group approached me personally to offer condolences. Many overlooked the family, who by all accounts had always been a bit distant. The privilege of the offspring and the grandchildren was on grand display. These children, now grown, rich, confident, well-educated, and diffident, were the end result of great wealth. This subtle and lingering arrogance, as potent as one of her signature fragrances. I made a few introductions to Charlene, who, as third wife and social climber, wanted to know Nan or Pat, the only other social doyens who mattered. And then, concluding this catalog of impressive guests, this growing armada of naval jewels, the other cosmetic pioneers arrived to pay their respects. Mickey Heron from Heron Cosmetics, and his long-rumored mistress, Cece Lopez, the founder of Queen Cece's Hair Relaxer, who was, in addition to being Mickey's girl, the world's richest African-American entrepreneur. The funeral had all the bearings of a state funeral. After all, Madame had gone over all the details with me for years. Her favorite, Senator Lautenberg, delivered the eulogy. The sheer drama of her incredible life and her unassailable will to succeed. The daughter of Jewish-Polish apothecaries who had braved new continents and built the largest beauty company in the world. 6,000 global employees, billions in revenue, homes and art and foundations. Buying and selling, and buying it back for pennies on the dollar during wars and depressions. Her story read like a novel or a fable. Her son Miles, now in his 50s, dabbed his eyes for effect as he recalled how his mother had braved the Nazis and English and French society. Only Picasso had not succumbed to her charms, deigning only to draw her and not paint her, the only artist of the 20th century who had held out against her dollars and her will. And then there was her beautiful grandniece Jennifer, who pulled the iconic pink and green Lashmatic mascara out of the bottom of her bag and said to laughter that if her grandmother had invented the contact lens, it would not have had the same impact on women's eyes and lives. Finally, at the tail end of the service, after remarks by the three rabbis, a visiting archbishop, and the wife of the Vice President of the United States, all of whom had their own rhapsodic eulogies, there was an audible gasp. She had arrived. As we all knew she would. Swathed in sable and diamonds, looking resplendent and confident and haughty, acting the part of the victor, her icy blonde hauteur more at home in Locust Valley than this citadel of Jewish prayer. She took a discreet yet visible spot, exactly the road Josephine said she would, which sent audible shockwaves rippling through the crowd. Constance Gardner was in attendance and enjoying her triumph over Josephine's demise, if nothing else. Constance, the society matron, the horsewoman, the belle of New York society, the other beauty industry pioneer. Their rivalry had been legendary and even scandalous. Constance had outlived Josephine. And in this way, Constance had won, even their longevity competitive. I personally had always found Constance a bit masculine for my taste, and also a bit scary. I knew she was going to approach me and deliver her final chess move. The Xanax had not dulled the anxiety and anticipation of that moment entirely. I tapped my English brogues and looked at my rose gold Patek, which Madame had given me for my 40th birthday. Knowing that for a man like me, age was not something cosmetics could solve. The rabbi intoned the prayers and let the crowd know that the family was receiving, after the cemetery, at Josephine's grand and fabled Fifth Avenue duplex. People always gaped at the gargantuan rooms, ceiling heights, and Dubuffet murals. They also repeated the story that after being turned down by the building's white shoe board in the 1930s, Josephine had simply bought the building lock, stock, and barrel under a corporate name. After divorcing her first husband, she lived with her younger Russian prince, taking New York society by storm. Some
said it was a... We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.